Hey, brothers and sisters, this is your favorite sleepy brother from another mother. Hope you guys are doing all right. Praise the living God. Praise the living God, brothers and sisters. Praise the Most High God. Hallelujah. El Elyon, Hebrew, you know. Yahweh. Hallelujah. Yahweh, our Most High God. Hallelujah. Our Heavenly Father. And bless His only begotten Son. Hallelujah. Yahshua HaMashiach. Hallelujah. Bless His holy name, brothers and sisters. Bless His name, for He is great and worthy to be praised. Bless the name of Yeshua HaMashiach, brothers and sisters. Bless His holy name. He is worthy of all praise. Hallelujah. You know, brothers and sisters, I was just wanted to ask you guys what I'm thinking about it for prayers for us, brothers and sisters, as we prepare. I'm getting ready to take off here in just a couple hours, going up to Chicago and Minneapolis, and then back to Chicago, then back here, then the next weekend after that, be up there in Petersburg, Virginia. So by the grace of God, brothers and sisters, by the grace of God, I just want to thank the Lord, brothers and sisters, and for all of His grace and mercy, brothers and sisters, for the physical strength, the mental strength, and the endurance to run this race, brothers and sisters. And I just thank the Lord for the orphanages. I thank the Lord for the opportunity to do the orphanages. I want to thank the Lord for all of you who have helped sponsor the orphans and the orphanages that we built and bought. And now we got one that we rent. Number four, orphanage is a place we're renting. Number three, we bought. Number one and two, we built. Praise God. Actually, number two, half of it, the original we bought too. Praise God, that I had before we ever started the orphanages. So praise the Lord for the four orphanages that we have. You know, I was just thinking about all the things the Lord had shown me about the number four. Well, there's four orphanages. And 1,000 kids that we feed every week. By the grace of God, we continue to feed even more. Always looking to increase. And the pastors are always looking to increase and include more pastors. New areas, by the grace of God, to keep doing this feedings. And I just want to thank all of those. And I meant to make a video yesterday. I didn't do it. Because I was getting busy talking to lots of brothers and sisters and preparing. I mean, that's the thing about when you go places, brothers and sisters, to do like the baptisms and meeting people to pray with them and talk to them about the end times or et cetera. You know, you have to coordinate. Talk to people and, you know, make sure that they can find the place and I can find the place and all that. So, you know, those little administrative things, brothers and sisters. You know, that's the one that's the time-consuming part. But, you know, it's worth it, brothers and sisters, for me to be able to meet brothers and sisters in the Lord and to be able to water baptize people, pray for people to be baptized in the Holy Ghost, pray for people, you know, to be healed, pray for people for salvation, pray for people and, you know, talk to people about the end times, answer their questions, and pray for them to get for words of wisdom, words of knowledge, all those things that the Lord would allow me to do. It's awesome. And 99% of the, you know, the daily stuff we have to go through life to get to do something for the Lord and minister to somebody for the Lord or to talk to the Lord makes it all worthwhile, brothers and sisters. You know, I was just, now that I'm saying it, I just come into my mind, you know, it's coming into my mind about like the Apostle Paul and those guys. You know, if you read the book of Acts, you know, they're traveling, going place to place, but you know, the Bible, when you read Acts and all that, and even in the Gospels, it focuses on like the action, you know, you know, when Paul went to, like when he went to a certain place and he, you know, like in Ephesus or something and Acts chapter 19 and he prayed for the people to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. Acts chapter 19 verse 1 in the beginning verse, the first few verses or there when he cast the demon out of the girl when they put him in Philippi, when they put him in the Philippian jail as a result of casting the demon out of they had purposely had that girl demon possessed with, you know, what is the Python spirit, the spirit of Apollyon, Apollo, same as in the book of Revelation, out of the bottomless pit, so that she could be an oracle. And so people get their fortunes told by that fallen spirit through this woman, so that it was their livelihood. So when Paul cast a demon out of her, even that demon said, hey, follow, listen to these men. They have the word from the Most High God. You know, even that fallen angel, that demon in her was speaking out the truth. Hey, these, you know, they, she followed Paul and Silas around and said, hey, these guys have the good news, you know. They have a message from the Most High God. And so Paul cast the demon out, and then they got mad because their livelihood was lost. But the thing about it, brothers and sisters, is all the times when Paul and the apostles were traveling from place to place, or when Jesus and his disciples were going from place to place, you know, they say that the Lord ministered for 3.5 years, is what is said by scholars. And, you know, what we have written in the book, in the Bible, in the Gospels, like John said, if everything that Jesus did was written, you know, there wouldn't be enough space to contain all the things that he did. But there's lots of downtime, you know, and they, you know, had to prepare. They, you know, they cooked their food, you know, even in after the resurrection, the Lord cooked fish for the disciples. But he probably did it miraculously anyway at that time. It doesn't say, but he had food prepared for them while they had been out fishing all night. But anyhow, you know, during those times when we are going from place to place, that's all that downtime. You know, that's the time that tries men's souls. I mean, that's the time, you know, when we have to push through, not when the good stuff is going on or the action is happening, but it's all those times in between, brothers and sisters. That's when we must endure all of the things of this life, brothers and sisters, and, you know, overcome the world, the flesh, and the devil, the death, hell, and the grave. So anyway, brothers and sisters, I want to thank all of you guys who have helped with the orphans. Couldn't have done it without my brothers and sisters in Christ. You know, and as Brother Gary, that's Bear0049, Gary and I were talking the other day, and, you know, he reminded me, it's true, and those of you who have been following my ministry, you know, once started Joshua's ministry, that, you know, I went to the Philippines on my own. I didn't have any denomination sponsoring me. I had an opportunity to be sponsored by two different denominations if I would join their denomination, be part of that. But the Lord has always led me, you know, I got ordained by independent group, you know, to be part of an independent, you know, loosely connected association of full gospel preachers. Because denominations, you know, the bad side of denominations is they build their own kingdom. But the good side, of course, you also can deal with false doctrine and things like that. You know, this is our doctrine and this is what we follow. And that's also a good thing to have some structure. But anyway, the Lord led me, because of my prophetic ministry, to stay out of that. And so as a result, the Lord supernaturally made a way for me to go to the Philippines and be a missionary until August 2012, when we started Joshua's ministry. And then, as Brother Gary actually was the one who had encouraged me, and there's another sister too, I won't say her name, another sister had encouraged me also that I should ask people to help me financially, you know, to give in order to do the orphanages and stuff. So I want to thank the Lord for that, and for their encouragement also to get started with it back in 2012. That's August, September 2012. But before that, brothers and sisters, I want to say this, because there's a sister who just emailed me. She had made an offering, or her tithes, actually, for the orphanages and stuff. And what she said about how the Lord had led her to give, and then she's been blessed greatly for doing that. That's really true, brothers and sisters. Not just Joshua's ministry. Like they say, it is really true. There's fertile ground. There are ministries that are fertile, and then those that are not. I guess it also depends on the faith of that ministry, you know, the anointing of that ministry, and the work of that ministry, and the walk of that ministry. You know, it's also, all those things are factors. But it's also true when you give by faith in the name of the Lord to, you know, anywhere. Of course, you're also being blessed. You're doing it by faith. And so it's like that, brothers and sisters. That's what I want to tell you. And I want to thank those who've given, and I'm not, you know, that's why I don't talk about too much, because I'm not talking about Joshua's ministry specifically. I'm giving you a witness and an example. Because I gave and gave and gave in the name of the Lord all over the place, all the time, you know, and never received any salary. You know, I worked full time and did the ministry, and I gave and I gave and I gave. And not only did I give, brothers and sisters, but I believed the Bible, where Jesus said, if you give, it'll be given unto you. And good measure, pressed down, pressed together and running over, will men give into your bosom, from Luke chapter 7. And with the measure you use, it'll be measured back to you. And he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, Jesus said. And so, and the Apostle Paul says God loves a cheerful giver. And then in Malachi 3:10, God says, put me to the test. Malachi 3:10, God says, put me to the test and see. Try me. See if I will not, bring your tithes into the storehouse and see if I won't open up the windows of heaven and pour out a blessing that you cannot contain, and see if I will, that I'll rebuke the devourer for your sake. Now, a lot of times what people will do to justify not giving to anywhere, I'm not talking about Joshua's ministry, I'm talking about giving to the work of the Lord, to true ministries, whatever they may be, that the Lord leads you, this is a true ministry of God in the name of the Lord. They will make the excuse and say, well, Malachi is talking about bringing your fruits and your grains and all that to the temple there for the priest to have something to eat there in Jerusalem. That's out of the Old Testament. That's there. Do I need to bring some grain to somebody's house? Well, they were farmers and that's what they had. That was their currency. So we are not under the law and we are not required to give a tithe. But I'm telling you, as Jesus said, if you give, it'll be good given unto you, in good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. That's the right way to say it. Now that I got it right, I have a lack of sleep, brothers and sisters. Because of the work of the Lord, brothers and sisters. But anyhow, I count it all as loss for the sake of knowing Jesus. Count it all as loss for the sake of knowing Him. Hallelujah. I count this earthly life as dung for the gospel of Yahshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Christ. Bless his holy name, brothers and sisters. For he is holy and righteous and worthy of all praise. And we are to offer ourselves as a living sacrifice. Romans chapter 12. And it's a shame. This is from the Lord. What I'm talking about, one here, the reason why the Lord is leading me to talk about this one. I'm talking about giving in the name of the Lord, to wherever the Lord leads people. But it falls under the category from the Lord God Most High. It falls under the category of offering yourself as a living sacrifice. Now, this, I had no idea I was even going to connect this or even talk about this, brothers and sisters, as usual. But when we offer ourselves as a living sacrifice, people always just talk about, like it talks about praise and worship. It's talking about that you can be meat, as it says in the King James, meat for the master's use, good enough for the master's use, that you be a vessel of honor, not dishonor, a vessel of gold and not of wood. And that when we are saying before the, I'm still quoting from Romans, and then in 1 Corinthians chapter 3, our works at the judgment seat of Christ, the bema seat of Christ, our works are judged whether they be of gold or hay or stubble. They go through the fire, it says, Paul says, 1 Corinthians chapter 3. And then the works that we've done in the name of the Lord with the right attitude and the right motive and being a cheerful doer and a giver of the things of God, then our rewards will be gold. They'll be tried through the fire and then we will have those rewards in heaven. God will take those rewards and shape them into a crown. But I'm getting into some teaching now. But the crown that we talk about, the diadem, the Greek word diadem, like the song, crown him with many crowns, bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. That's the crown that the Lord gets, a royal diadem for a king. The crown that we get is like when you run a race, like where they would take the olive branches. It's a different word. I can't think of the Greek word right now, but it doesn't matter. It's a different Greek word for the type of crown that, like, that the, you know, like when they run the races, they wear those olive branches. It's like that. It's not a diadem, a royal diadem. So the crowns that we have are not the same as that. I know a lot of people, I don't know why the Lord is even to say that, but he is. It's not that kind of a crown. It's a victor's crown, And so a victor's crown is one of the crowns that we have, and it's like when you run a race. And so in the old days in the Olympics, they'd have the olive thing twisted around, but it's going to be made out of gold. But it's made out of the righteous deeds we did in the name of the Lord. Not our salvation by works. I'm not talking about that. That's where a lot of times, that's why I don't like when you're talking to Baptist doctrine and all that. Because it's all about being born again, born again, born again. But after you're born again, what do babies do? They learn to eat on their own. They learn to walk and talk and go to the bathroom, all those things. And then they become a mature, steadfast in the faith Christian supposed to be. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11 through about 14 or 15 in there. to become the mature stature of the body of Christ. And so our works that we do as a result of our faith is how we get our rewards. And that is based on when we stand before the Lord, He judges us the thoughts and intents and motives of our heart. That's why when people, this is where the Lord has really given me a lot of wisdom right here, brothers and sisters, in this video. When you follow the law, you know, your righteousness is not by faith, but by the law, which no one can follow it exactly right anyway. But when you stand before the Lord, just like let's look at giving again, and you say, well, Lord, I tithed. You know, the law says, you know, to give a, you know, give a tithe. And so you gave a tithe. And then the Lord looks at you and says, well, my word says I love a cheerful giver. See, because the Lord judges the thoughts and intents of your heart. And He says, well, you gave that money because you wanted to get a plaque with your name on it. You know, my great-grandfather was a deacon in a Baptist church. And he had donated part of the money to build a new church. And it's my own great-grandfather, you know. I believe he's a Christian. But there's a pew with his name on it and a little plaque up there, you know. And, you know, I don't know if he liked that or what he thought about it. But I was a little kid when he died. But Jesus is going to look at people that, you know, and say, oh, well, because He judges the thoughts and intents of our heart. Some people wanted their name on that plaque, and that's why they gave. And so the Lord will say, this money you gave was so that you could show off to be a pillar of the community. You know, your heart was all about being exalted. So since you did that, when your works of giving, you know, a bunch of money to build a church goes through the fire, well, it gets burnt up. It was hay, wood, and stubble, and it wasn't gold, so you lost the rewards from that. You see, now this is how it's going to go down, brothers and sisters. Last couple of videos, I've been getting into some theology stuff, and this is the real theology, brothers and sisters. Not some nonsense you heard from people on YouTube who are not pastors. So, anyway, this is how the whole thing works biblically, brothers and sisters, how God's going to do it. This is how the Lord's going to do it. So, if you give as a cheerful giver out of the pureness of your heart for the glory of God, whether it be for sponsoring orphans, or if you give to feed the children, or whatever, say any, well, you know, whatever's a Christian ministry, it's done in the name of the Lord. It's not given to the, you know, the New World Order Foundation for Orphans, no, but to a Christian organization or yourself, like you yourself. Like I say, not everyone is called to go out here, but let's just say there are lots of people who use the excuse, well, you know, all these churches are all a bunch of junk and all these ministries are fake. Okay, you go down into your city. You know, you buy some groceries, you go door to door to poor people's houses and you give them the groceries and you say, I give this to you in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. You give them the gospel, you know, and then you be responsible for going there as a preacher and follow up with them and disciple them and make sure they either you disciple them or you plant them in a church. But the double-edged sword of that, well, if you think those churches are not good enough for you to help them, then why would you send people to those churches? You see what I mean? So it ends up where, you know, either you're going to serve the Lord or you're going to donate for other people to serve the Lord. If that's what God called you to, if God called you to serve the Lord as a minister, or if He called you to donate for someone to do that, to buy Bibles. As an example, there's a brother down in Dallas, you know, and he's looking at helping, working with the Gideons. Now, you know, the Gideons go out and give out Bibles. Now, that's another example. You know, you take your tithe and buy Bibles and give them away. It's another example, just one of many, any kind, brothers and sisters. So anyway, the Lord had me talking about this. I don't know why exactly. But it all falls under the category, the bigger category of offering yourself as a living sacrifice, brothers and sisters, in all things. Through praying, taking time off from watching your, I was going to say Ellery Queen, from watching your Perry Mason, whatever. Mr. Ed, maybe you've been watching Mr. Ed at night instead of praying. You know, you need to get off that Mr. Ed kick. Mr. Ed, what would you call it? Mr. Ed, kick or a marathon. You've been on a Mr. Ed marathon. You're running the wrong race. I should make a video called that. If you're watching Survivor marathon, that's the wrong race to run. That's not the race that the Lord called you to run. You know, the Lord has called us to run the race of patience and endurance to finish the race that He's called us to do. To run for Him, you know, because it says that we're surrounded by a great crowd of witnesses. You know, people love to say, you know, we're encompassed about by a great crowd of witnesses and say, oh, our dead relatives who are Christians can see us and all that. But the focus of the text is the fact that we're running that race for all of heaven to see. And the focus is to finish the race and run the race that God gave you to do. Not about, ooh, our relatives are looking at us, our angels are looking at us, the host of heaven are looking at us, whatever these different theologians want to say it means. The focus is to run the race, not who's watching. Because there's only one person that counts who's watching you. And that's what I'm trying to get across to you. That's where I'm always coming from. There's, you know, I'm not a people pleaser, never have been. Whether people are dead or alive in heaven or hell, wherever, I'm not worried about pleasing them. I'm worried about pleasing one. That's our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He's the only one I'm trying to please, brothers and sisters. By the grace of God, you know, I try my best daily to never be motivated by the whims of people, but by the glory of God and the will of God, by His grace, Anyway, brothers and sisters, offer yourself a living sacrifice. That's the message from the Lord today. In all things you do, in everything, do all things to the glory of God, the Bible says. Whether it be, you know, in the city, in the country, in the mountaintop, in the valley. If you're in the valley, praise God. If you're on the mountaintop, praise God. If you're in the city, praise God. If you're in the country, praise God. Hallelujah. If you're wealthy, praise God. If the, let the rich say, I am, let the poor say, I am rich. Hallelujah. Let the weak say, I am strong for what the Lord has done, the Bible says. And it's a song also, Don Moen song. Anyway, brothers and sisters, praise Him. Praise Him wherever you are. Lift up your voice and offer yourself as a living sacrifice and praise and worship our Lord. Give all you've got. I'm just thinking about it now, brothers and sisters. Look, I'm on here because God told me to come on. And I'm just, the things that I'm telling you is to be an example to you, brothers and sisters. Very few people are running the race. I guess it's a tithe. Maybe 10% of Christians are running the race. You know, and I'm so, me personally right now, I'm so exhausted, so tired. I'm being honest with you. You know, and the Lord wants me to be. And you guys have been watching my videos. You can see there's lots of times that I'm tired. Because I, just like what Paul said, you know, I count it all as lost for the Lord. You know, I'm running that race. And when you run the race, brothers and sisters, hey, you're going to be tired. You know, if you're not tired, if you're not, you know, weary in well-doing, you know, that's what Paul said, you know, don't grow weary in well-doing. Well, if you ain't doing well, then you can't get weary of it. A lot of you guys are weary from doing nothing. You know what I mean? You gotta be weary of well-doing. Brothers and sisters, get out there. Get out there and do the race that God called you to do. Join me in the on the field. Join me on the field. Now, you know, the downside of the pre-tribulation rapture, I'm a very big pre-tribulation rapture guy, as you guys know. The downside of the pre-tribulation rapture is when I start talking to Christians about doing something for God, they're always saying, well, the rapture's going to be any day now. We've been, the church, Paul, the Apostle Paul thought that he would see the rapture. Read his writings. Read what Paul wrote in the Bible. What did he say? In first, I know he was talking about the church, but I also believe he took it personal when he said, the one of the biggest rapture texts, when he says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16, he said, you know, the we shall not all sleep. Oh, that's 1 Corinthians chapter 15, 51, and 52, 53. That's also the same text. He's, in that text, he said, we shall not all sleep. We shall not all sleep, but we shall be changed in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, at the last trump. You know, this will take off this corruptible and put on incorruption. Now, in the other text, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, which I was got them crossed up. I say, I have a lack of sleep, brothers and sisters, so just pray for me. But I got to drive 2 hours, too, here in this about an hour. I better drink me some coffee, brothers and sisters. You know, and I don't care who thinks drinking coffee is a sin. If you think drinking coffee is a sin, you better call Begley because I think he drinks 10 gallons a day. So, but anyway, brothers and sisters, 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, Paul says that, you know, the dead in Christ shall rise first. And listen to what Paul says. So you gotta read the Bible and you gotta like read it and then receive it. Paul says in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verse 16, he says in 17, the dead in Christ shall rise first, and those of us who are alive and remain shall be caught up together to meet the Lord in the air. So shall we forever be with the Lord. And there's other texts where Paul talks about that. And so, and there's, if you read the writings of Paul, you will see that he was thinking that the rapture would happen in his lifetime. So it did not. As we obviously know, we're still here. Do I believe the rapture is going to be in my lifetime? Yes. Do I believe the rapture is imminent? Yes. Do I believe the rapture highly possible it could be this year? Yes. Highly, 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 highly possible. Is there a possibility that it might not be this year? Yes. Is there a possibility it could be 5 years from now? Yes. People keep saying, oh, I don't, you know, it can't be. No man knows the day or the hour, brothers and sisters. We never know 100%. My opinion, if I were going to bet, I would bet that it's imminent, you know, in the next, very soon. Imminent, not any long time off. When I say long time, I'm talking 5 years, over 3 years. More than likely sooner than that, we don't know. So, brothers and sisters, we have to run until the day the Lord comes for us. And like I said, what I try to tell you from the beginning from the Lord, when we get to heaven, when the rapture happens, let's say the rapture happened tomorrow, and we get to heaven, and then you're going to face the Lord, I'm going to face the Lord, and then the Lord's going to say to you, well, for the last, since 2011, you've been sitting around saying, well, I'm not going to do anything, I'm not going to go to Bible school, I'm not going to, you know, like all the people that message me, don't build an orphanage because the rapture's going to happen tomorrow, and don't write a book because the rapture's going to happen tomorrow. All those people, my brothers and sisters in Christ, the Lord's going to be like, you're supposed to occupy till I come. You know, you've been sitting around wasting time for 3 years. Especially when we see that the Lord's about to return is the time that we should be doing more. Because we have plenty of time to rest when we get to heaven. That's the point, not the opposite. People having the opposite. And that's why the post-tribbers, you know, are, you know, one reason why they criticize us pre-tribbers. Because it's like, you know, we're not, and I want to say this. I'm just saying this because the Lord is leading me to say these things. And I want to say this. Post-tribbers are preparing for tribulation. But we are preparing to meet the Lord. So that's the right thing to do. I'm preparing to meet Jesus. I'm not preparing to worry about what I'm going to eat. I'm preparing to meet the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, there's nothing wrong with saving your canned. A lot of people, I get somebody asking me that every day. There's nothing wrong with saving canned goods. There's nothing wrong with being prepared. I'm not saying that. I'm saying that the post-tribbers are preparing to fight the Antichrist. And we are preparing to meet the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's the thing to do. So there's nothing wrong with having some stuff stored up. And like I say all the time, like about the orphanages and all those things, when people make some corny comment, why are you, you know, building orphanages when the rapture's going to happen? And why would you, you know, have extra food if the Lord's coming? It's going to be for those left behind. It's so simple what the Lord told us through the Apostle Paul, Romans 8:28. What a great, simple verse. All things work together for the good of those who love God, who are called according to His purposes. So, if I had 20 cans of green beans here, you know, and I'm not a huge fan of canned green beans, unless you can them yourself from the garden. If I had 20 cans of factory canned green beans in here, and 20 cans of Spam, yum yum, somebody can eat that, brothers and sisters. Somebody, some tribulation person, can come here and eat that food. Think about this. You know, the Lord has given me lots of wisdom while I'm making this video. I'm getting lots of good wisdom right now. And I'm hearing this from the Lord, all the things I've been telling you. Listen to this. I want you to get this, imagine this. Can you imagine when the tribulation is going on and then somebody's got a kid, let's say something, because you can have, I have to explain everything. One time I said something about kids and somebody's like, well, all the kids will be raptured. People are still going to be engaged in procreation activities after the rapture. So if you would use your imagination like Mr. Rogers and go to that magic happy kingdom, you would know. let's go to the magic kingdom, brothers and sisters. Doo-doo. Okay, so in the magic kingdom of the tribulation period, and it's not, yeah, I guess it is it's a kingdom of magic. Yeah, the Antichrist is into evil power. I mean, it's magic, right? Isn't magic what the devil does? Okay. So in the magic kingdom, I think I need to make a video about that. Life in the magic kingdom. I got to remember these things. But anyway, brothers and sisters, imagine if you had some cans of food in the closet and the rapture happens And then can you imagine if someone has a baby during the tribulation, and then they go to your house, and then they find out they're starving, and they're told, you take the mark, and we got all the food that your baby wants. Let's imagine the baby's old enough later on, which they would be, if you had a child conceived the day after the rapture, could be like 6.5 years old by the time the Lord returns. So you got this little kid, a child, and then the child is starving to death. And then you're told, take the mark and you can feed your child. Or don't take the mark, you know, you're hiding in the closet and you guys are going to die. So here you're watching your little kid. You guys have become, you become a Christian or whatever during the tribulation. There you're looking at your baby, 2 or 3 years old, and your child is starving to death. Now, do you take the mark so your kid can eat, sacrifice yourself to go to hell for eternity so your kid won't starve? Now, this is the kind of things that people's going to be facing, brothers and sisters. Think about that. With people that are so excited about being in the tribulation, I've even had people contacting me and said, I'm not going to get saved after the rapture because I'm too busy having a good time. I'm going to survive during the tribulation. Tell me how to survive during the tribulation. Well, imagine what it'd be like to eat your own arm, okay? I mean, think about that. Or get your head chopped off or not, you know. So, this is from the Lord, brothers and sisters. You imagine those canned goods that you had in the closet or in the basement. And that person, this woman, she finds the canned goods. She's able to give those canned goods, just ration it out to her and her baby so that they don't, so she doesn't have to take the mark. Imagine that. That is what leaving food behind can do. It can save someone from eternity in hell. Me making these videos, there's people that can watch these videos. When the tribulation begins, the internet might not go down or get censored for weeks or months or whatever. Who knows how long? Get an underground internet where people could have exchange of Christian videos. You never know. So everything we do, whether it be now or in the magic kingdom, is all for the Lord. God bless you, brothers and sisters. I want to pray for you right now. Let me pray for you. Let's worship the Lord for a second, brothers and sisters. Father, right now, in the name of Jesus Christ, the Son of the Most High God, Lord, Father, we come before you right now, Lord God, for your holy, worshipful, mighty name. Father, we give you the praise. We give you the glory. Hallelujah. Halamasubai. Halamasubai. Kinamasu. Halamasubai. Hallelujah, Father, we honor you. We praise you, Lord God. You are worthy of all praise and glory. Hallelujah, Lord. Father, we delight in you, Lord. We delight in you, Lord God. You are amazing, God. You are an awesome God. You are amazing, God. Hallelujah. Bless you, Lord. Hallelujah. You are amazing, God. All powerful, yes, Lord, unchangeable. You set the stars in the sky and you know them by name. You are amazing, God. Hallelujah, Lord. I bless your holy name, Lord, Father. We honor you, Lord. We worship you, Lord God, for you are worthy, Lord. We magnify thy name, Father, in this place, Lord God. You are awesome God. Hallelujah. You are the awesome God. You are the great I am. Age to age, still the same. Awesome God. You are the awesome God. You are the great I am. Age to age, still the same. Awesome God. Hallelujah. Father, we bless your holy name, Lord Father. We bless you, Father, in the name of Jesus. Father, right now, I just pray for your people, Lord God. I pray for all the people watching this video right now, Father, in the name of Jesus. And Lord, we know you're outside time, Lord God. Someone can watch this a day from now, 6 months from now, 6 years from now, Lord God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. And it's still the same effect. I see our Lord. I see our Lord Jesus right now, brothers and sisters. I want to tell you, I see the Lord. I see him right now, brothers and sisters, in a way that we don't like to see the Lord. I see the Lord on the cross. I see the Lord on the cross. shedding his blood. I see the precious blood of Jesus right now, brothers and sisters, dripping out from around the nails and the pierced hands of our Lord Yeshua HaMashiach. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, the Lamb of God that takes away the sins of the world. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all of the glory and all of the honor in this place. Makes me want to shout. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all of the glory and all of the honor in this place. Hallelujah, Lord. Father, just bless thy people, Lord, with a revelation. Hallelujah, of what you've done. You lived, you died, you rose again on high. You opened the way for the world to live again. Hallelujah for what you've done. Hallelujah, Lord. We praise you, Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord God. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Yes, Lord. He is worthy to be praised and adored. Hallelujah. We lift up holy hands in one accord. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. We honor you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. Father, I ask you just to bless all who watch this video, Lord. I speak right now, Lord, your blessings of health, wealth, wisdom, peace, joy, love, salvation, deliverance, kindness. Hallelujah. Meet in due season. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. Just release your blessings upon your people, Lord God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. Just deliver those, Lord, who need to be delivered today, Lord God. Hallelujah. In the name of Yeshua HaMashiach. In the name of Jesus the Christ, Lord Father. We honor you, Lord. We praise you, Lord. Hallelujah. All those who are burdened and heavy laden. Jesus said, come unto me, all you who are burdened and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Hallelujah. For my burden is easy, my yoke is light. I speak right now. I keep hearing the word from the Lord right now. Guilt. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you have guilt, cast your cares upon the Lord, for he cares for you. For the Bible says, if we confess our sins, he is just and faithful to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. 1 John 1:9. The other text I quoted is burden is easy. Matthew chapter 11. Hallelujah. 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 Give all guilt. Once you repent, you are free in Jesus' name. By the blood of Yeshua, he died for you. He himself took upon our sicknesses and our diseases. Hallelujah. He became sin for us who knew no sin. The word of God says. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Father. We thank you, Lord, for the blood of Jesus that cleanses us of all unrighteousness. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I have a word. I have a verdict. The Lord has handed down a verdict for his people, for the saints, for the bride. I have a word from the Lord for you, bride of Christ. Not guilty, says the Lord. Not guilty. Not guilty. Hallelujah. For I have set you free. And those whom the Son has set free are free indeed. And the Lord wants you to know, I died for you, says the Lord. I died that you might have life. Hallelujah. No man takes my life. John chapter 10. I am the good shepherd. No man takes my life. I have the power to lay it down and the power to take it back up again. Hallelujah. And the enemy comes not to, but to kill, steal, and destroy. But I have come that you might have life, and life abundantly, said the Lord Jesus Christ. John chapter 10, verse 9 and 10. Hallelujah. He is the good shepherd who came down from above. Hallelujah. And washed us clean in his own blood. He is the Christ. He is the Messiah. He is the Son of the living God who came from on high, who set us free that we have no need to die. He is the Christ, the King of Kings. That is why he wants us to sing. Sing, sing, sing unto the Lord a new song. for he is great and worthy to be praised. Hallelujah. 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 Put your faith and trust in Christ and sing a new song, for he has given you a reason to go on, to go on and go on unto the finish of the race. You can do it all by his mighty, mighty grace. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah for the Spirit of God. Hallelujah. For the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. Hallelujah. To speak the good news and proclaim the gospel, the good news of the Christ. Hallelujah. Even as the Lord Jesus Christ prayed in John chapter 17 at the Last Supper, he said, "Let them be one, Father, even as you and I are one." Brothers and sisters, may we be one. Hallelujah. Jesus said, "All those who are not with me are against me." Hallelujah. He who does not gather scatters. Sing, all you people, shout unto the Lord with the voice of triumph, for the Lord has given you the kingdom. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Hallelujah. Delight thyself in the ways of the Lord. Hallelujah. And he shall strengthen thee and guide thee. Hallelujah. 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 Blessed be the name of the Lord God Most High. Hallelujah. 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 Praise his holy name. Hallelujah. 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 Blessed be the name of the Lord God Most High. Hallelujah. He is awesome and mighty in this place, worthy of all praise and glory, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Magnify thy name, Lord, in this place. Magnify thy name in your people, Lord God. Yes, Lord, set thy glory upon your people. Hallelujah, Lord. Speak unto your people, Lord, not by might nor by power, but by your Spirit and by your word, Lord God. Establish your kingdom, Lord. Hallelujah, in the hearts and minds of all of your people, Lord God. Take it forward, Lord. Take it forward, Lord. Deliver thy people from the snare of the false prophet and the Antichrist in this world, Lord God. Deliver thy people from the snare of the fowler, Lord God. Father, we honor you in the name of Jesus. Salvation is of the Lord, brothers and sisters. God bless you all. Is that what I just did? Most of you know. It's called flowing in the Holy Spirit. Brothers and sisters, you know, I'm just going to do whatever the Lord tells me to do and flow in the Spirit. What I just did, which I've been doing before, it's just flowing in the river of the Spirit of the living God and just speaking prophetically. That's prophecy. That's flowing in the Spirit of God, what I'm doing. And several videos, not all of them, but that's what I was just doing, brothers and sisters. Hearing from the Lord and speaking it out to you, what I was hearing in my heart from the Lord. You know, lots of times people, who denominational people, they say, well, you know, people say God spoke to them. Well, Jesus said in John at the Last Supper, he said the Holy Spirit will not speak of himself, but he'll speak of those things he hears from me. So the Holy Spirit speaks. And so where does he speak? He is in the hearts of believers. So he speaks in the hearts of believers. The Holy Spirit speaks. Hallelujah. By his grace, brothers and sisters, by his grace. I love all you guys, and I appreciate, as I said, I really thank you all and appreciate all those who've helped me with the ministry and all those who pray. I need your prayers desperately because, you know, I'm going into traditional areas that are not very Christian areas in the United States. You know, Chicago, Obama lives is from, you know, based out of Chicago, so. Pray for me there as I go into the enemy's territory around there, more than this part of the country, you know. Just pray for me as I go there. And I know that the Lord is with me. I know I've got the victory already, but prayers make the road easier, make the way open. for the intercession of the brothers and sisters in Christ, and I need your prayers. That's what made me be able to accomplish 100 times more. I've been able to accomplish 100 times more in a lot of ways since I started Joshua, the YouTube channel and Joshua's ministry, because of the intercession of you guys. I had lots of progress in the States and went to the Philippines, but I didn't have any prayer warriors when I went to the Philippines. You know, all the people that all the churches I planted, all the people I helped, the Filipinos who immigrated to the States that I worked with, they all started chasing the American dream, aka the American nightmare, biggest house, biggest car, all these things. And they forgot about the Lord and forgot about the ministry after they got out of hard times. You know, lots of people are like that. When they're in hard times, they seek the Lord. And when everything's flowing good, like I said from the Lord in this video, when all, those of you who are on top of the mountain, praise the Lord. Those of you who are in the valley, praise the Lord. That's what I'm talking about. You know, he has an ear, let him hear what that means. That means that when things are rolling good and you're a high roller and you're high on the hog and you're living large, praise the Lord. Lots of people don't praise the Lord when they're living large and high on the hog. They praise the Lord when they're in the valley. And then when they're on top of the mountain, hey, they're kicking it. You know, as they say, they're kicking it with their homies. They're not thanking the Lord and giving the Lord the honor. It's like what Israel did. And so that's why the Lord has to send us back in the desert lots of times, brothers and sisters. If you're tired of being in the valley and tired of being in the desert, when you get back to the top of the mountain, or when you get back to the promised land out of the desert area, don't forget to praise the Lord. And when you praise the Lord when things is going great, that's when the Lord is like, hey, this person is getting beyond corruption. You know, they're getting beyond being able to be, you know, caught up with the trinkets of the world. You know, someone's, you know, ooh, look, be mesmerized. A new flat screen TV. Ooh, ooh, look at this. Ooh, shiny new car. Ooh, you know, trying to mesmerize you and draw you away from the Lord with all these things of the world, whatever they may be. You know, I'm using some simple examples, materialism, but, you know, pornography, whatever, that might get people caught up. Anything in this world, brothers and sisters. You know, there's nothing wrong with people sometimes watching TV and stuff like that. You know, I mean, we live our lives and all that, but our heart has to always be dedicated to the Lord, brothers and sisters. You know, and the more you give to the Lord and offer yourself a living sacrifice, the more the Lord's going to bless you. Anyway, brothers and sisters, God bless. God bless you. I got to drink me some coffee and get rid to hit the road. God bless.